Okay, here we go. Welcome everyone to tonight's episode of Profound States. As usual, this is your host, Charles Michael Mike Beaver. Tonight we're here to welcome Kenneth Hopkins, right?
Is it? Yes.
And I don't have his bio right in front of me, but I'll just let him introduce himself. Go ahead and introduce yourself, Kenneth. Tell everybody about yourself.
Okay, for me, I didn't know I was involved in abductions until 2001, 2002. I had blackouts that were usually with dates, girlfriends. They go anywhere from 45 minutes to most of a day to 16 hours. And I tried to get assistance through many psychologists to find out what was going on during the blackouts. They're referred to as missing time by Bud Hopkins, but for me, they were just blackouts. And they would interrupt whatever activity I was in. Driving a car, boom, the clock on the car is an hour ahead. So it wasn't until 2001, 2002, I started to get flashbacks. And then I started seeing a series of hypnotists.
So, hold on a second. There we go. So, before we got on the call, on the recording, you were talking about that you thought the Grays were messing with you before.
No. The Grays I have total trust in. The military abductions and the Mkultra, I have not yet seen a correlation to. So whether, because so many kids my age were pulled into the Mkultra projects, that I can't say that was involved or that was something that just happened. They went to school systems for the Mkultra. They're looking for people that are very susceptible to hypnosis. And they were recruiting them out of the schools. They're recruiting them from many different places.
But you said that somebody was involved with you from before your birth. That was...
And this, just about a year ago, I was talking to my wife who works for United Nations, and I was telling her I was German. And my son corrected me. He said, "No, Dad, you're not German. You're Scandinavian," which made no sense because my mother's German. So then when I started looking at the documents, I saw that I was of... a Scandinavian parent, mother. My father's genes they took. His sperm, they combined it with a Scandinavian egg, and then that was put into my mother by the Grays. The Grays informed me they were the only ones with that technology in 1953.
So your contact with the Grays in some fashion has been pre-birth, is what you're saying?
Yeah, they played a role in the embryo implant. And I, as I've said, I've come across others that are embryo implants that are not of their parents' genetics. So a lot of the different ETs were doing this as well.
What's the first thing that you remember happening to you that was odd in your life?
Wristwatches never worked.
No, I'm talking about when you, from your childhood. Is there anything from your childhood that is odd that you remember?
No, most of the only thing as a child I may have remembered is missing time. And when I didn't have awareness of time, wristwatches and so forth, I didn't even recognize missing time. I didn't really become aware of the missing time until I was dating.
So what was the very first thing that happened in your life that was odd that you remember going back, whenever it happened, whether it's childhood or adulthood? What's the very first odd thing that you remember?
Scuff marks on my shoes to the point where the shoes were worn through. And that was in my adolescent years. Of course, I told you wristwatches never worked. I went through a lot trying to get a wristwatch that worked. Today, they don't work on me. So the scuff marks on my shoes was something I had no explanation for. And it was literally to the point where the leather was worn through. And so up until about 21, I was probably the only thing I didn't understand how the leather on my shoes was worn through.
Well, you mentioned, and when we talked before we started the recording, you mentioned something about something that happened with Mkultra that was very...
The Mkultra I see as separate of the abduction phenomena. I don't see them as directly correlated. And many children in the 1960s were being brought into these projects. And as I mentioned, Yale and Harvard were participating in these out of Boston Children's Hospital. In my writing, I mentioned the doctor's name that did the procedures with the IV. They brought it. Again, I didn't get into these memories with hypnosis. Because I really didn't feel they were something I had control over. As I mentioned, I don't know if there's a correlation with the MKUltra or the military abductions.
Well, okay, so I remember listening to your interview with Jeff Mara, if my memory is correct, and you said you have multiple personalities. Is that true?
In dissociative identity disorder, and I was trying to get the blackouts that people experience in abductions, and many times are connected to dissociative identity disorder, which would be multiple personality. Often in the abductions is the other personality. That's why the missing time phenomena is very much associated with the multiple personality. So some of my abductions I have memory of and some I don't. Rarely, I have some memories of the Grays, but for the most part, I don't have any memories of the Grays. The Pleidians, I thought, were dreams as a child. The experiences with them, their school, I all thought that was a dream people. So I really didn't correlate anything with them until I was much older, when I was seeing the same people at night for 4 or 5 years. But I didn't put together the Pleidian abductions until I started looking at the Grays abductions and what was happening to the women that were in the vehicles with me when we had missing time on the dates. And that was in 1975, 76, and 77.
Well, so looking back on your abductions with the Grays and the Pleiadians, first of all, before I ask you the question, is there anybody else who's abducted you besides the Grays and the Pleiadians?
No, it's pretty much been the military, the Grays and the Pleiadians, and I've been introduced to other celestial groups by them.
Well, before you get into the abduction stuff, we need to start from the beginning. So I believe, if I'm not mistaken, your first experiences that were odd of any kind were Mkultra. Yes?
Yeah.
Okay, so tell the audience about those first.
All right.
Since they're first, chronologically speaking.
Okay, I'll tell you about them. I was diagnosed as mentally retarded. And I was raised with a lot of head trauma with a parent, which would bring on seizures. But because of the learning disability and the level, the severity of the head injuries, I had learning disabilities. So Boston Children's Hospital with what they called mixed dominance.
Stop for a second. Hold that thought. Your mother hit you, yes?
Yeah, there was a lot of beatings, head traumas in my early years.
Right.
From my mother.
Okay, go ahead with your story.
So those were later attributed to the learning disabilities. The fear in a learning situation, the parent being the first of your teacher. So my parents hired a lawyer. They didn't want me going into special class. So then I was sent to Boston Children's Hospital. And I was about 59, 1960. And as I mentioned, I did not explore what happened in the sessions with hypnosis. One session came to light with hypnosis, which was with the IV in the arm and doing things to a young child. And some ways I chose not to fully deal with those memories or what was going on with the Mkultra. They would pick me up at my home, take me to different places, have me see some horrible things, and I'd have no memory of any of this. And eventually, with the tutorial, I was able to get back into school, 2 years behind, eventually go to college. I don't have any more memory of that than age 6 and 7 and the visits 8.
So stop for a second. So do you have, you said this made you see some horrible things. Mention something you saw that was horrible.
A man would pick me up at my house. My parents had an agreement that they would provide transportation. He'd pick me up at my house and take me to places. I had flashes of those places. They usually involved killing people, witnessing killings. But as I've told you, I've not chosen to go into them. With the therapy I'm in now, we may be looking at some of those things.
So, have you come to any idea why they made you watch terrible things?
Are you familiar with the Mkultra program?
I am to a point, but you know,
it was a set procedures they did.
Well, the understanding I have is that they cause you to split your consciousness,
yeah,
so that they can. The notion, the Mkultra, the ideas of Mkultra came from supposedly the Chinese and the Russians were creating similar people, and we did it to counter what they were doing.
Yeah, I read all the justification for this human experimentation or whatever you want to call it. And they certainly found a way to justify it because they said, it creates wars. So sacrificing one life to create a war. So they had the psychiatrist, the therapist, they all found the rationale. But basically, the dissociation was created by trauma, severe trauma. And the trauma was severe enough so that the mind couldn't accept it, or that consciousness that the person came with couldn't accept it. Once they started the division, then they can train what they created in the division.
So, you don't know it. How much of the MKUltra stuff have you tried to reintegrate your different personalities?
We're working on that. And the personality with the MKUltra was Brian. Brian was the one, the personality they set with a trigger. I know we didn't find out. We were able to bypass and get into some of the experiences. But again, most of that hypnosis was somewhat limited. That wasn't where our interest was with the MKUltra.
So your therapist that you're working with now, are they using hypnosis to help you?
What we're doing now is to make the personalities present during the sessions. And then we're working discussion with the personalities to eventually integrate.
Right.
But we're working, I was doing this with a hypnotist for 3 and 4 years, but we're just dealing with the personality, speaking with the different personalities.
And how much luck have you had reintegrating the personalities?
For the most part, only one personality actually interfered with this reality. The interdimensional realities had the other personalities involved. The abductions they used the personality Kenneth, the Greys did. The Pleidians had particular personalities that integrated with the female Pleiadians or the female contactees. As the personality split occurred, the abuse on the youngest became of the personalities, which is Kenny. Kenny left. And then another personality, we'll call Ken, came in. And then Kenneth was the protective spirit or protective personality.
So how many personalities do you have?
At this point, I was trying to get assistance with the military on this. And at first they agreed to assist me with it. Then they changed their minds. So, 6 to 8 personalities, but I believe we're down to 3 or 4.
Because you've been able to reintegrate.
Somewhat integrate. But the most of the integration is in the interdimensional. Kenneth was being a protector, was a fighter. And in aggressive situations, he would step in. Resolve them quickly.
So when you say interdimensional, okay, so go forward in time from the times you had your MKUltra stuff to anything other than the MKUltra that was happening to you that was odd. What was the next thing in your life, either an abduction or anything else that was odd in your life?
Wristwatch is not working. The scuff marks on my shoes I became aware of as an adolescent, but I had no explanation for them. And then when things in the mid-70s, missing time became real prevalent. Blackouts, up to 16 hours, most of a day, those became quite prevalent. And I had no explanation for them at 22.
So do you think these blackouts were more multiple personality or more abduction or both?
I think they're both.
Okay, so who started abducting you first? The Grays? I assume the Grays, right?
The Grays, pretty much, I would say, yeah, the Grays. But as I was mentioning to you, I don't have much, a very limited memory of experiences with the Grays. And the Grays used the personality Kenneth to interact with when they took me. So when Kenneth came, that was the blackout.
So has Kenneth been reintegrated? It hasn't been reintegrated yet because you would have those memories, right?
As far as Kenneth being needed, he wasn't needed anymore. So for the aggressive situations that came up, I couldn't deal with Kenneth's brutality. Eventually, I dealt with the aggressive situations on my own, without the use of Kenneth.
So
when the Grays took me, they would utilize Kenneth.
So I remember your Jeff Marr interview. You mentioned that one of your personalities was not, that you believed it wasn't a personality, that it was an actual spirit. Separate spirit that was inside of it.
We're very confused on that because Kenneth has spoken in mediums, several different mediums he's spoken through. We've asked him questions and he answers them. He's answered them through a medium. Kenneth had stipulated that we're two souls in the same body. Kenneth has not supported the theory that he's a personality. But all of this right now, we're leaving open for the therapy we're starting. But for the most part, Kenneth has been gone.
Well, obviously, if it was just another personality of you, it's obviously not going to talk through a medium. I mean, you know that, right?
That's what we assumed. That how can a personality speak back and forth to this personality?
Yeah, well, one of your personalities cannot get out of your body and talk through a medium to you. That's not ever going to happen.
No. So we're not making any assumptions at this point, but it appears that Kenneth is another spirit.
And you don't know who you really don't know who he is yet.
Other than what he's exchanged in dialogue with me. I know he's from past lives, American Indian. You'd have to get more specifics on the questions, but Kenneth is an old spirit whose many past lives were with the American Indians.
Okay, so go forward to the first abduction. Let me phrase this differently. Since they used Kenneth in the abductions, do you remember any of your abductions?
The ones that were occurring with the women were just blackouts, no memory. It wasn't until 2001, 2002, we did several years with different hypnotists, did we find out from Kenneth what happened in those abductions.
So relate anything you learned through Kenneth about your abductions.
Well, Kenneth was fulfilling the Gray's purpose of putting embryos in the girls that were in the vehicles with me. He would mesmerize them. When he came, it was a blackout. When he left, I came too. And those would be what I call blackouts or missing time. So Kenneth was doing work for the Grays to put embryos in the women that I was dating.
So why do you claim you seem to explicitly trust the Grays?
Yeah.
Why do you trust them so much?
Well, the surgery that they've been doing on me, I had a lot of anger with what they did to the girls. The Graves have looked at other people for me to see if they were okay, if they were physically okay. They have done corrective surgery on a particular loved one. They have done, like I said, surgery on me. Their perception of man being of two choices, those that serve self and those that serve others. Some of their philosophies, they never lied to me. If I have a question, they'll answer it.
Is there any abduction you've ever had with the Grays that you remember yourself, your current personality?
Yeah, there's probably about 6 to 12 that I remember.
Oh, can you start? Why don't you start going through those? It doesn't matter what. Just give us the year, close to the day,
okay,
and the events, and just go through them, you know, one after the next. No, there's no hurry. Just take your time.
Okay, now we're looking at not the ones that came up through hypnosis, but the ones that came by free memory.
Don't matter. Whatever. I'm as a hypnotist, I trust hypnosis a lot more than most people because I am a hypnotist, so I don't distrust it like you generally hear in the general population.
Yeah, we've been conditioned to distrust it. Especially
right.
With the wide diversity of the Mkultra.
Yes.
But I found it an incredible healing tool.
Yes. Go ahead and go through those experiences.
Okay. The most traumatic one I'll start with, and that was a 16-hour missing time experience. The young woman I was dating at the time, and this is in my book, was with military intelligence. I wasn't aware that she was with military intelligence. So after she had a series of convulsions that were very violent, the Graves took us both. And it took us a long time to get what happened in that 16-hour missing time period. But basically they disassembled her to show me the implant, the cerebral implant in her head, and asked me if I knew what that was. She went through a lot of screaming prior to them disassembling her. I don't have a perspective or understanding of the Gray's medicine. But basically, they took her head apart and they showed me the implant that connected to the brainstem. It was about the size of a thumb, my thumb. And I only remember fragments of that, but basically they disassembled her, asked me if I knew what was in her head. It was obvious that what was in her head caused the convulsions. So I believe what the Graves were trying to do was to help her.
So you think that that somebody else put the implant in, not the Graves?
In my book, I put the project in there and the pictures of a child in that project. And it was listed as Monarch Project.
So you think that we put it in her?
It was done. It was done by the humans. And the photographs, the photograph I posted was a CIA release of the procedure that had been done to her. These are being done in 1661. I've interviewed doctors that have removed them. I wasn't able to find out what their exact purposes were, but I believe they were able to, like a primitive GPS system, provide location. It looked like they worked off of the body's electrical system.
So you recovered this memory through hypnosis. Now you're on
38 years later.
Yeah. So you're on board the Greys, disassemble the military intelligence lady, show you the implant, ask you about it. What do you remember telling them about the implant?
I didn't know anything about the implant. And I said, I don't know.
Okay. But you've come to believe that we put it in there.
Yeah, because I've studied the experiments and all of the MKUltra procedures. And in the picture I put in the book, it shows a child in that procedure.
So what's the name of your book?
Earth Transformation was the name of the first book.
You have a copy with you?
Unfortunately, yeah, I have a copy. Hang on. I had to borrow one because I gave them all away. I don't think I could photograph this enough, but I can show you the picture.
Just show the front of the book.
Oh, okay. This would be
Earth Transformation, Revealing Galactic Soul Consciousness Ken's Interdimensional Journeys.
I worked with a professor on this.
So is it still in print?
It was taken out of print about 2 years ago.
And you want to show something in the book? Go right ahead.
Well, I was showing, I can't. This is the child that they're tuning the implant in. But you can't see many of the words. And I've interviewed numerous subjects of these procedures. That, or these children that were a part of that, those procedures.
So you can still buy your book on Amazon?
No, it's out of print right now. I had to borrow it from somebody I gave it a copy to, but a lot of what I wrote in the book, as far as the story UFO girl, was not totally correct. So in the rewriting, I'm including many subjects that weren't in the original work.
So
I didn't know she was with military intelligence.
So the book is not available at all through Amazon right now?
No, not right now. But I'm in the process of rewriting it. And that's what the writing has been on has been on the UFO portion. The other thing I did is we put photographs in the book. We also included hypnosis sessions in the book of three of the personalities, Jim, me, and Kenneth.
So do you think the MKUltra stuff has finished, or do you think they're still doing it?
The last mission in teleportations, we were doing some missions. Again, I'm not convinced those missions are connected with the MKUltra. When we're teleported, they can't. It's difficult to kill us when we're teleported. They can't shoot us. We can go through solid objects. And so I have photographs of the teleportation process. I was referring to it as plasma teleportation, but I was given some more information talking about it as a slightly different form of teleportation. So we return in a bright light, a very bright, painful light, and that's what I was photographing. Or the visitors will come in a very bright light. And then they'll take form and become solid. And I refer to that as interdimensional.
So when you teleport, when you were teleporting, why were you teleporting? Give us the circumstances surround teleportation.
Being teleported for surgery. Being teleported for, with the military, we did some missions. Excuse my cough. I have a chronic cough. And in these missions, we did things. Shooting people. And in the last mission, I had a tantrum in the last mission, and that was the last of the missions they've ever had me participate in. I didn't find the killing justified. And
how old were you when you had this tantrum during the mission?
Well, we were to enter a facility. I and a partner, we were to take out everybody in the facility. We had a small automatics that we would take them out with. Taking out the second guy, the gun jammed. And being somewhat confused, also a little bit more conscious, I whipped the gun at my partner. And as it turned out, they didn't find the documents that we had entered the facility for. And I have to be somewhat vague on that because I don't know the exact particulars. My impression was we're looking for uranium. And the facility was involved with the movement of uranium. That was the impression I had. But no evidence was found to verify. Because then after we took the people out, others came in, took all the files, took the computers, and then they went through everything.
So you're saying that the military has teleportation technology?
Yeah. The military has all the technologies the ETs have. They monitor us closely. They're able to teleport. They can't compete with the Greys in medicine. Greys can do surgery and leave no marks. I posted the marks they left on the military left on me when they replaced the lung. I posted in my older posts last year. I end up with 12 broken ribs, and I've been going in and out of surgery, more surgery to repair the other rib. So that surgical procedure they did in the abduction pretty much left me disabled last year.
So who's paying for your surgery for your ribs?
Right now, I'm a disabled veteran.
Oh, so the VA pays for it.
VA is paying for, they put metal plates to bring five ribs together, one of those plates broke, so I'm going back into the hospital again. I posted the surgical marks that were done in the abduction. And I was in a lot of pain. And following waking up from that surgery, I was taken by ambulance into an emergency room.
So did you tell the VA how you got your broken ribs and why? When you answer that question, tell us how you broke your ribs.
Well, what happened, and what the hospital had declared, the lung became infected with Omicron, which created viral pneumonia just in that lung. That was the only area of infection because the body had the immunity. The viral pneumonia and the cough, they had to break the ribs to put the lung in. The viral pneumonia and cough rebroke those ribs all the way down the line. So there was some repair work being done in the abductions at night, but ultimately with the 5 severed ribs, it had to be done surgically.
So your lungs got attacked by one of the coronaviruses.
Yeah, the Omicron.
Yeah.
Viral pneumonia was the diagnosis. And when I went in the hospital, there were 2 broken ribs initially, and then the ribs slowly all broke all the way up.
So they had to break your ribs to fix your lungs.
To put the lung in, they did a temporary break. This is what I'm assuming. They did a temporary break to be able to get the lung, the old lung out and the new lung in. They didn't expect the cough and viral pneumonia to infect the new lung. When that happened, that just cascaded into breaking all the ribs on the left side.
So go back.
I can show you. I'll send you some pictures of their surgery.
No, I'm good. I'm good. So go back. You were starting to go through your abductions. Now, you mentioned the one where just mention that one that you mentioned before. What happened during the one that you mentioned previously just now, a little while ago?
When they're taking apart the young girl's head?
Yeah. Okay, so did anything happen in that abduction beyond you explaining you didn't know where she got the implant?
They put her back together again, and then I was driving a car with her sitting next to me. 16 hours later, I was driving a car with her sitting next to me. So she seemed to be pretty much back. There was some question that they were going to look to remove the implant in her head. I don't know if that really happened or not, and I'll be looking into regressions to find out. My impression is they may have removed the implant from her head. There'll be another episode of her going into convulsions in the middle of a swim, going across a lake, swimming across a lake. We lost 6 to 8 hours in that episode. So I'll, in hypnosis, I'll be reviewing whether it seemed like they may have removed the implant. 3 years later, they shot the girl in the head.
Who shot?
I'm assuming the military shot her. A contract hit was taken on her. I was curious, trying to get some answers to questions, and went to approach her. And prior to my approaching her, she was shot in the head.
So she's dead now.
No, she survived the gunshot wound. Federal protection took over, and I couldn't get near her.
So who do you think shot her?
Mkultra works within, there's an organization that's referred, that was referred to in my questioning as Mkultra, the international. They work in conjunction with the military. The military uses their services. My impression was the military that hired her were the ones that had concern with the information they gave her and her speaking to me. So that was why they took her out.
But she survived.
She survived, and probably part of it is because what was going on with her brain may have been the reason she survived the shot. Her husband was the one that had the contract. He was with the Mkultra, they're known as handlers. He was assigned the task of shooting her. So when he shot her, he assumed she was dead when he left the house. He had several aliases. And other than that, I made several attempts to try to get in touch with her. But it became apparent it wasn't safe to.
So go forward to your next abduction after that one.
Okay. There'll be 12 women involved in this series of abductions from 75 to 77. In my second book, I write about 6 of them. In my first book, there's about 4 or 5 of them that's mentioned. Those are the blackouts. And at 22, 23, a series of homicides happened in a small town to people that I had met, and I ran into the Navy at that point.
We'll go through the actual abduction.
Okay, in most of the abductions, most of the girls, they would put embryos in through their vaginas. And then let them come back, and then 5 weeks remove the fetus. Then the fetus would be put into incubators. And then the fetus would be raised in the incubators till it didn't need the incubators anymore. And that was how they were trying to find a way to reprocreate their genetics.
You're saying that they were all used as breeders?
Basically, the 5 that they, 5 of the ones out of the 12 were used as breeders. They never used the woman with the implant as a breeder. They took her sisters, I believe they were looking, and they never used them for the breeding. They took the sisters, I believe, looking for implants in the sisters. So that seemed to stop 77, 78. Those blackouts and missing time stopped.
Well, go through your next abduction you talked about the one with the lady, with the military intelligence lady who ended up getting shot that had the implant in her head. So go through the next abduction that you're familiar with, regardless of whether it's...
Okay.
We don't care how it was recalled. I don't care.
Okay. All right. The next one, when I went to the Navy, I had several relationships, and it was pretty much the same pattern that was done to the other women when I was in the Navy. Inserting of an embryo and then taking the fetus out in 5 weeks, 6 weeks. Now, the Pleiadians also had their breeding program, which was very different.
So, you're saying that you had a series of abductions that were only mainly for the sole purpose of using the women that you were with as breeders to implant them and remove the fetus, whatever from them.
Yeah.
And so you just happen to be along, is what you're saying, with all these.
No, there's, I don't know the reasons. It was like I was kind of bait. Or that's the way I felt. I'd go to take a young woman out. Kenneth would take over. He would mesmerize them. The Greys would take them. They'd do what they needed to do to them. Then they'd return them when they were done. And it was usually 45 minutes to an hour, maybe an hour and 15 minutes. They're relatively short periods of time that they'd do the procedures in. They'd be done in their ships. They'd be very done quickly. The ship would be usually near the car, behind the car. And so those five were pretty much the same thing. Kenny mesmerized them. I blacked out. The women were taken aboard the ship. There's some cases where they took semen from me, but I could only speculate why they took, you know, those women. A lot of people have speculated that pre-birth agreements existed between the subjects the Greys used to put their embryos in. There was an abduction five, six years ago, with a woman that was done in 76, where the Greys are trying to get her to forgive them for what they had done to her. In that abduction, I was present. They abducted her. She was from Illinois. They had me. And she would not forgive them. She was furious. She was angry. And they were trying to get some kind of reconciliation with her. They weren't able to get it with her. That was like 6 years ago.
So go segue for a moment from the Greys to the Pleiadians. Go through the first Pleiadian abduction you had and tell us about that one.
Okay, the first ones, I was being taken in my pajamas at night and we were taken to classes. But we'd never remember the class. We'd never remember the subjects of the class. We'd remember prior to the class, the women that we were with prior to the class, and we'd remember some memory after the class was over. We'd never have any memory of the substance of the classes. In those classes, they were teaching us physics, sciences, formulas, and I'm hoping to recover some of these with the coming together of the memories. But the Greys or the Pleiadians have no use for our educational system. They feel that most of the educational system is fake. They don't see substance in it. And so when I went to college to study engineering and physics, they were sabotaging computer and courses. And they made it plain they did not want me studying these physics and sciences.
So
how that was like 6 years ago, 7 years.
How did you even know? I mean, did you ever actually see the Greys? I mean, what did the Greys look like? And once you get through, tell us the story of when you first saw a Grey that you remember, regardless of whether it's under hypnosis or not. Okay. Tell us the first story where you actually saw a Grey and describe it.
Okay. Kenneth and I decide to interchange, I would enter his world. That was early 2000s. Then I had conscious experiences of the grays when I was Kenneth. And in those, they were working on the seizures. Because the seizures were getting dangerous, they had a lot of concern with the seizures. So they were becoming somewhat typical. They'd take me, they'd put wires on my head. And there were several different kinds of grays. There was the shorter ones, the taller ones. I believe it was the tall whites initially in my earlier ones. They were tall, 7-8 feet, bald. And they seemed, in the early ones, they seemed to direct the ETs as to what to do.
Do you ever watch Linda Moulton-Howe? Do you know who she is?
Yeah, Linda Moulton-Howe gave me a lot of leads that helped me understand what I was experiencing.
Okay, yeah. So there's an episode she has, I think it's actually very extremely recent, but it could be as old as 2 years ago. And in this episode, she shows a Nordic, a drawing of a Nordic on the left side of the screen and a drawing of a tall white on the right side of the screen. Okay. Now, the tall white is not a gray. It doesn't even resemble a gray. The body looks like a human body, and the face looks very much human, but not human. And, you know, very different, but very similar. And it's not like a gray at all. Now, when people say tall whites, sometimes they mean tall grays that are white, and sometimes they mean the being she's talking about that is more of a human body and something else facially.
But yeah, it's pretty close to a human facially. They're about 7 feet, a little taller than 7 feet. Of course, they telepathically communicate. They're white. They're not gray. They were in my early experiences. They were also in my son's early experiences. It seemed with the later on experiences, they disappeared.
So you're talking about a tall white that is a Pleiadian? Is that what you're...
No.
No? Okay, well...
I don't... You know, there's so much I don't know. All I know is what he looked like and that he was directing the grays to doing the activities they did. He talked directly to me telepathically.
Describe, go through that, the event you're talking about. Try to recall the very first moment of that event and go through the whole event and explain exactly what happened.
It was an argument I was having with him. When the girl had convulsions in the water, they took us. That was the six hours plus something missing time in the middle of a lake. They didn't want to send her back alive. They thought it was best that she die quietly in the lake. And that's what they told me. I became very angry. They thought it was best that, as they said, that she die quietly in the lake. In the actual experience, it seemed like she did die. And then next I know she was alive and arguing.
Okay, so go back up for a moment and... this is a tall white, yes?
Yeah.
Okay, so what race do you think the tall is? We just call them tall whites and we don't want to know what to call them beyond that. Is there any other description you can have besides he's tall and he's white? And He had a body of a human, looking like a human.
Yeah.
It's like the one in Hal's picture.
I haven't seen her picture.
Well, okay. So it looks like a human body, and the head looks very much human, but not human, you know, very different, but very similar. And the eyes are different, and there's different things about the head that you can tell it's not a human. He couldn't walk amongst us. The Nordic could walk amongst us, but the tall white could not. And what do you have any other designation about this tall white?
Bald, other than
the tall white,
over 7 feet, mouth and nose. There's some differences in facial features, but I always had trouble recalling specifics in facial features. But they definitely didn't look human facially.
That's understandable. My client, their face, what they look like from the neck up was the last thing she recovered when I worked with my client after 4 sessions. It took 4 sessions for her to get any face at all.
Yeah. They did another thing to me where faces were obscured. So in many of the abductions, when they were close, their faces were fogged. Just, you know, they weren't clear. It was like blurred. Now, I don't know if that was some programming they did on me so I wouldn't be scared of them. I have a lot of problem in regular life with facial discrimination. And I question whether that's something that was done.
Sorry about that. My wife walked in.
Oh.
Anyway, hold on a second. So, of all your Pleiadian encounters, the first thing I'd like to know is, how do you know they're Pleiadians? Why do you believe?
I didn't. Until 2 years ago. All I knew is they looked like us. If you look at all my early writings, they look like us is all I keep saying. ETs that look like us, that's how I describe them.
So when did you first come to believe they were Pleiadians, and why did you do that?
Kenneth called them Nordics. In a dialogue that was going on between the medium, me, and then they came up and said they are not Nordic. Nordic broke off of their culture many years ago. They proclaimed they are not Nordic, and they identified themselves as Pleiadian.
So you learned this, how, tell us again how you learned this.
Kenneth was speaking through a medium, and I was asking questions. And probably because of the Scandinavian gene, Kenneth assumed that they were Nordic. And they corrected Kenneth very clearly, saying that they're not Nordic. The Nordics broke off of their race. I don't know, hundreds of years before, but they broke off of their race.
So when you were talking to Kenneth through the medium, the Pleiadians were present at that moment?
Yeah.
Okay, and they corrected Kenneth.
They're very quick to correct misinformation. And so they corrected Kenneth when he called them Nordic, almost as if they were insulted.
So
that's when I realized they were Pleiadian.
So go to the first event where you had any abduction with the Pleiadian. and go through that experience?
I was about six, and they'd take me at night to school. And I used to tell my mother, I thought they were dreams. Why am I having dreams of going to school in my pajamas? And I would see the same children over and over. And the classes pretty much continued on and off throughout my whole life. So from six and seven, Angry Brunette, I gave them names because they didn't have names. Angry Brunette and Tall Blonde would remain me with visiting at nights till about 2002. Angry Brunette was the last time I saw her. And Tall Blonde, the last time I saw her was in the 90s.
So all these experiences with the Pleiadians are all recovered under hypnosis, or do you?
No, those I remember. A lot of them I remember.
Even the childhood dreams, you remembered those without recovering?
Yeah. Because okay. I was trying to figure out I thought I was actually in school. And then I was told, no, these are dreams of inadequacy, showing up in your pajamas in school. That's what my mother's explanation was. And I didn't have a reason to, I assumed dream people were dream people. So you have the same people over and over you dream about. So that didn't seem unusual to me until I was much older. And then I became more consciously aware of the experiences with Tall Blonde and Angry Brunette. Usually with Tall Blonde, they're teaching us medical information, medical procedures. With Angry Brunette, they're usually teaching us mechanical things, all of which currently don't, I don't have I couldn't make sense out of.
So you say Tall Blonde and Angry Brunette, you're talking about females.
Yeah. She was like 60.
Getting clarification there.
What?
I'm just getting clarification there.
Yeah. She was like 6 feet. She was almost my height. She was tall. Called her Tall Blonde.
Did you run into any of the male Pleiadians or just the female?
There was a male child Pleiadian, but he disappeared. He was with us for a few years, and then we didn't see him again. But most of my interactions with the Pleiadians, like 90% of them are female.
And so we've gone through an hour and 10 minutes. And,
oh, God.
We haven't spent that much time. We've gone through a lot of information in an hour and 10 minutes. I didn't expect we'd get anywhere near this far in an hour and 10 minutes, but can you go through any experiences in detail on board that you have not gone through that would help out at this point?
They were showing me a medical procedure. And it was kind of funny. I was behind glass in a ship, and people were coming out to have these procedures done to them. They are putting what looked like a long plastic Teflon needle into the back tooth. So the men were lined up to have the procedure done, and the men went off. They weren't compliant. Very argumentative. Eventually they dismissed the men, and a group of women came in for the procedures. The women were laughing. They were quite compliant. They had no problems with the procedure. That was one experience I remember. And I was watching.
Was that Pleiadian or Gray?
That was Pleiadians.
Okay, go ahead.
When Kenneth had me take his place, then I got to have a group of experiences in 2002, 2003, 2004. And I wrote a lot of these on Facebook, where they were putting electrodes on my head. There was one particular gray, somewhat heavier set on my right side. And then there was some smaller ones in front. And the one on the right side, he acted more like a doctor. And what they were working to do was to stop the seizures. Eventually, the seizures went away. So I feel they were successful in stopping the seizures. But during the series of those abductions, they had taken a woman that I'd get to meet with them, and they removed her from her home. Oh, I forgot what state. They removed her because they felt the abuse on her was too dangerous. They were afraid of her getting killed. So they removed her from her home. So when I first met her in their ship, she was handcuffed. And they explained to me why she was handcuffed, because of her aggression level and so forth. So through a series of those, I would meet her and develop a relationship, somewhat of a relationship with her. There was another one. The tension was incredible. I don't know. I don't understand the reason for their tension, but the hybrid woman they brought aboard the ship, or was aboard the ship, they're going over me physically. They're doing a complete physical evaluation of me. And then they had me go into a room with the hybrid female. They acted like she was of a high-ranking official. The way they bowed to her, just the tension level when she was in there. So I went into the room with her, and then I don't have any memory what happened in the room. Under hypnosis, we tried to recall what happened in the room. And the pain became extreme in my right arm. And I wanted to continue, but the hypnotist didn't, so she stopped the session. So I don't know what happened in the room with her. I'm assuming it was a mating of some sort. I don't know. So the Grays had an interest in the microwave facilities. The photographs we were taking showed microwaves going through them. So they wanted us to check out a plant, a facility in the middle of the woods, had a short 30-foot tower. They wanted us to enter the facility. There was a group of us. Amelia was the woman, and they wanted her to assist in entering the microwave facility. We ended up having a fight outside the microwave facility. We never entered the facility. And then I got injured in that fight. And an injury that lasted about 6 months with the shoulder and arm muscles.
So why do you think they were interested in the microwave facility?
I didn't put it together, but the fact that the microwave frequency was coming through the room. Let me show you. If I can get that picture. The microwave looks like a rope. Of course. Okay. These are teleportation pictures. See that thing going through the center of that picture?
Yes.
That was identified as a microwave frequency. There's a better, if you look at it, almost looks like strands of a rope. So I believe the Grays took an interest in the microwave Because here's a better picture of it.
All right.
Because it was coming through the bedroom. So I believe they were curious.
Your bedroom.
Yeah. Those pictures are from the bedroom of the teleportations. And the microwave seemed like it was a trigger to the plasma teleportations. At some point, it would come through the room. I don't know if it picked up on the electromagnetic frequencies, but anyways, they wanted us to check the microwave facility. And we end up fighting on the outside because they did, the people I was with didn't feel. So the Gray sent us down to go into the microwave facility. But the people that I was with, that the Gray sent down with me, didn't feel that was their job. And so an argument, and then we were teleported back.
So go to the teleportation, the technology that was used to teleport you. Can you describe it, what it looks like, and that sort of thing?
I have
photograph.
These are black and whites, but it looks much better. Let's see if I can find. That picture is of me returning. But it looks horrible in black and white. In color, it has numerous colors on top of each other.
So how did you get that photo?
I set cameras up, and it destroyed a lot of the cameras. So we ended up getting an old Swan camera from Radio Shack. And that, there's videos I haven't finished putting together of the process, but those were a series of stills we were using. So we're using a Swan security camera, an old one from Radio Shack. That was the only thing that could record. The other ones would black out or the batteries would explode. So we had to use AC. So the Swan camera, and then we also used the camera that's put out by Bushnell for the hunting cam. And the hunting cam picked up a lot of things, including another form of teleportation. But if you had a plasma incident, it would destroy the electronics of the camera, explode the batteries. But the Bushnell hunting cam was able to get some pictures that were pretty good. It shows people splitting into two, one leaving. One remaining in the bed.
So who was teleporting you? I mean, why were they teleporting you? You know, I know the Grays were picking you up through teleportation and putting you down, but I mean, when you're teleporting from Earth and you're not being abducted, who was teleporting you and why were
Pleidians would teleport me for the classes and for the experiences with them at night. Initially, 30, 40 years ago, they would teleport me to the ships. Later on, I'd be teleported to other areas on the planet.
What you're talking about is to and from ships. I got the impression, the way you were talking, that there was some reason you were teleporting that had nothing to do with ships. Is there any other reason other than being teleported to and from?
Well, the military did surgery. The missions the military had. The Grays used a different method that I can't describe. I could never get pictures of the Grays, of them. My son walked into the room, sees the Gray. So that's when I started setting the cameras up. I didn't know the Pleidian abductions were abductions. I thought they were dreams. So my wife and I discovered then that I was leaving the house at night. The Pleidians could be breeding, bedrooms, classes, and early on, their ships. They had communities living on ships. I don't know where these ships were, but groups of people lived on these ships. And the earlier abductions were to the ships with the Pleiadians.
Can you describe the internal... Can you describe the ships of both the Greys and the Pleiadians?
The Greys are relatively small ships, 30, 40 feet across, maybe. I was always confused by the hypnosis and then getting into the ships. And they were fairly visible. The Pleiadians had gravity. It was like a town living on them, a community living on them. I could describe the rooms.
So did you see these ships mostly internally, or did you?
It was
see
always them? Internally.
And did you see any of them externally?
No, when I did have the gray ships, I saw occasionally externally, but and they were usually traumatic when I saw them. They bothered me. The Pleiadian ships weren't anywhere.
Stop. What do you mean they bothered you? Why did they bother you?
I think, and I found this with a lot of people, that it was described with a sighting in Beverly, where the officer that was witness had to be contained. They had to put him in the back of the car. But a lot of people, the ships trigger traumatic memories. And for me, the ships seemed to, the little ships of the Greys seemed to bother me. I didn't like seeing them. I didn't want to see them.
They were triggering some memories.
They were triggering some memories is what I assumed. So I didn't want really. One part of me wanted to see them, but I really didn't like seeing the ships. The other ships were.
So hold on, stop for a second. So you trust the Greys, but yet their ships trigger you. Do you realize the disconnect there?
What happened to the women was very traumatic for me. They're screaming. And so I equate that. The other thing, the Greys did surgery on me. These are just coming. As a child, they did surgery on me. They take me apart. Take an arm off, take fingers off, put me back together again. As a child, these were frightening. I'd wake up on the table and be partially disassembled. So I think as a child, anything with losing a limb or is traumatic. So I think that could be some of it. But what the Greys were doing, I know, wasn't hurting me. It was, in a sense, repairing something they had a problem with. One time, they had removed my eye. And I got up, tried to walk around. They put me back on the table. So as a child, when I had these dreams of being dismembered, I would just go back to sleep and wake up in my bed. And so that was how I, and those are traumatic. But I know the grays weren't hurting me.
So what you're saying is that even though you think they're good beings and they helped you out a lot over the years, some of the things you experienced in their presence freaked you out.
Yeah. I'm freaked out by phenomena. A woman forming in taking solid form in my bedroom is quite frightening for me. I'm used to the world as it's supposed to be. We're all programmed. This doesn't happen. That doesn't happen. But with the technologies of the different groups, we're experiencing all these things, and maybe it's a feeling of loss of control.
So, you trust the Greys. How do you feel about the Pleiadians?
I'm having some conflicts with the Pleiadians. But the Pleiadians, I feel closer. The level of objectivity I found in the Greys has made me feel closer to them, perhaps. The remembering and not remembering with the Pleiadians, you'll remember when it's time to remember. Everything you know is within you. There's a lot of unanswered questions with the Pleiadians.
So could the Pleiadians walk amongst us and you not know they're the Pleiadians?
I believe so. And they are living in communities on Earth. When the Pleiadians
have stop. How do you know? Because
I visited those places on Earth that they are.
Where are those places?
One place is in the Alps. It's a mock village. There's three different groups of Pleiadians. There's those born of Earth from the seedings that they did tens of thousands of years ago. The Pleiadians consider those part, and they utilize them in the breeding program. There's the Pleiadians of their planetary system, far away. And then there's the ones in the ships that are adapting to Earth. So I kind of got three different groups of them. So, hold on, stop.
So you've bifurcated them into three groups. Just because you have categorized them that way, that doesn't mean they're really three different groups.
In the breeding project, I went into women's homes on Earth. And in the interviews, I interviewed women of Earth that were born of Earth that were in the breeding program. So I can say, and they're telling me that they seeded Earth tens of thousands of years ago. I have a reason to believe they have concern for those of Earth. And they're very different than those of their culture. Those of their culture has a whole different set of dynamics and sciences occurring in it. Perspectives, them helping or training others to adapt to Earth. It's an interesting transition. So that's why I put them, because of my experiences with three groups. That's why I put them as three groups.
So you've there's a village in the Alps that the Pleidians are living in.
They have an adaptive community living in it.
Right. And there's a Pleidians living in on the home world. And then the other group is the ones on the spaceships.
Well, there's ones like me living on Earth.
Right.
And then the initial ones I met were on the ships. The ones I had relationships with were on the ships. The initial relationships and classes were on the ships.
And then there's the ones that are actually on their home worlds.
There's ones like me.
That are on the home worlds.
Yeah. Okay. They're of their genetics is what they said.
So, is there anything you haven't, it seems like we've just like flown through everything you have to say in an hour and a half, which is not possible. I mean, I know there's a lot more that you haven't mentioned.
The Pleiadians have been teaching me their political and economic structures. In one of the books I'm working on, I'm reflecting that, plus I'm interviewing other contactees with their different groups that they're with to see the economic and political structures they have. So this is a project I'm just starting. The Pleiadians believe in what they call the source or the creator. They consider the gods are the lower beings. They consider serving the creator is us loving one another. The Pleiadians have not killed in their culture, they told me, 2,000 years was the last time another Pleiadian had killed another Pleiadian. They don't have a profiting system. Their economic system doesn't have the incentives that have kind of led ours astray. To serve the creator, we love one another. Thus, the creator serves us all. So their belief systems, and this is why I'm getting a collection from the different, there's over a dozen different selectuals involved with humans. So with Facebook, I've been able to speak with people in different countries.
Well, stop. Are there a dozen different what involved in?
A dozen different celestials involved with this planet that are interacting with humans on this planet.
When you say celestials, what do you mean?
From off this planet or origins not of this planet.
Okay, so, yeah. Okay, go ahead. Tell us more.
So, what the book I'm starting on, it's called Celestial Communications. And so the people I've come across that I'm in touch with that are involved with different celestials, I'm catching their celestials show them their worlds. And I'm asking for them to ask their celestials about the economic and political systems. And that's what I'm working on with this other project that I kind of just started.
Well, one thing I'd like you to do is whenever you talk to any of your associates who have contacts of their own, if they desire to come out like you have, please give them my contact information so that I can have them on my show.
Sure. The Blue Avians is one group that I've come in contact with. I've come in contact with a lot associated with the Greys. Amongst each other, we're very open. When they hear of my experiences, they easily tell of their experiences. So I have the group that I want to facilitate their communications with their celestials.
And
with specific questions.
So do you have any contacts with any beings besides Pleiadians and Greys?
I've been introduced to others. I don't know where. I've been introduced to other planets. So I can describe some of the features. There's one group very much looking like us, body physically, but facial distortions, or they come across as facial distortions to me. A group from planets with a heavier gravitational field, so that they're stocky and stubbier. On their planets, I had trouble standing. I don't know who they are.
Hold on. You just glossed over something, really. So you've been to some other planets?
Yes.
Okay, we'll go through all of your non-terrestrial experiences.
Non-terrestrial?
Yeah, well, we've already gone over your onboard. Okay. So we've gone over your Earth experiences. So if you've been on other planets, that's what we want to know about.
Oh, okay. I guess I saw those as terrestrial. One of the planets I had visited looked a lot like the moon as far as the dust, but people were living in a dome, and they're showing me how they're using these metal rods to nourish the plants. And they
were growing. How did you get to this world?
The teleportation process takes us anywhere.
Whose teleportation process?
The Pleiadian, the military. It's instantaneous travel.
I mean, who took you to this planet in particular, the one you're talking about now?
I could describe the being that was on the planet when I arrived there.
You don't know who took you there?
I just woke up. I just was sent there. It could be the military.
So you have no clue who took you to that planet?
Who sent me there? No.
Who sent you there?
I have no clue 90% of the time where I've been sent. So I'm asking the people. I said, what state are we in? Where are we? And then I get answers from them. But I don't know where I'm going. They're expecting me. They know my name when I arrive. The language is, they seem to have a perspective of English, but no, I don't know where I'm sent to.
So tell us
why I've been calling them abductions.
Keep going through the experience with the planet, with the dome and the dust. Tell us more, the rest of that story.
All right. I was visiting my home at the time. And with a lot of us, when we visited, they would come and they'd take us out of the house. And this being, I'll describe him somewhat like an elf. But he was under 5 feet, had ears. He was the one that took me to the planet with the glass dome.
So stop. Okay. Before, you were just saying that you had experience with the Greys and Pleiadians, and then you mentioned a tall white, and now you're mentioning an elf. So you've had experiences. It sounds like you've had experience with at least four different groups of
faith. Yeah, a lot more than four. Hold on, stop.
So go briefly describe all of the different races that you've had experiences with directly.
Okay.
Briefly.
Okay. Woman with two heads. I'm not sure where she was from.
How did you encounter her?
that was in the breeding program. It seemed like she was on Earth. Kitchen, house.
But you're not sure.
Like I said, I go to bed at night and I wake up somewhere else. It would be nice if they told me where I was going to go.
That is pretty funny.
So that's why
not funny to you, but it's funny to think about. It's not funny to you when it happens, but it's funny to look back on, you know.
It's confusing. That's why I call mine abductions, because I don't know where I'm going, and I don't know when they're going to take me. The graves will often let me know what surgical procedures are coming up.
So continue going through this story. You're on this planet. You're in a dome. They got dust. Tell us the rest of that story. Go into
okay. It's a small dome over maybe 400 feet diameter, and the people were putting they were growing plants in the dome, and they're using these metal rods they were sticking into the soil that I assumed facilitated the growth of the plants. And then that was it. I was there. I saw them putting the rods in the plants and so forth. They weren't human. They were smaller. So that was...
Go ahead. Describe their physical details.
The one that showed me, brought me into the place, seemed different than the ones that were there. He almost looked like the guy from Star Wars. The teacher.
God, that's a lot of aliens. A lot of aliens.
I know. The one that teaches Kenobi.
You mean Yoda?
Yoda. He almost looked like Yoda. He had the ears, the bald head. He was short. So he kind of reminded me. The others, I was seeing them from behind. I was watching them work. They had hair. I can't quite describe what they would look like if they looked at me. I was seeing them from behind.
And go over what experience, how did you get to the point where you were seeing these particular aliens from behind?
The little gray guy I'm walking with outside, and then boom, I'm in the dome. And then I'm watching them put the rods in the plants, which well, I...
You mentioned an elf. Go back to the elf and describe the elf.
He looked like Yoda. Not quite. He had the ears. He was about 4.5 feet. He was quite comfortable with me. He came, we walked, and then boom, we were in the dome.
So how many times have you run?
May have been a different color.
How many times have you run into this guy that looked like an elf?
That was the only time with that one.
And how did you tell us the story about the elf from the beginning to the end? What all happened with the elf? The very first moment you saw him okay. To the time he was no longer around. What all happened with the elf?
I found myself walking outside. And then, so he must have come, taken me out of my room. And then suddenly in the dome. And
then you're back in your bedroom or whatever.
And then I'm watching them work with the plants.
Okay, that's right, yeah.
And then I'm back in my bedroom.
Okay, so go through some
so
more.
So the whole experience might have been 15 minutes to a half hour.
So go through the rest of the aliens you've come across, that you've had interactions with. Besides the, there's the Pleiadians, the two-headed lady, the Greys, that's three. And then the I guess the short people that were on the planet they took you to, that's four. And who else?
She had, or it was a female that brought me there. And she had hair, but there was a powder on her skin. There seemed to be a powder on her skin, because when I shook her hand, powder came on my hand.
I thought you said an elf took you there.
I'm talking about another experience.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm talking about the one you just mentioned, the woman from the planet of the high gravitational field.
Okay, go ahead.
She was very stocky, very broad.
Well, go through that experience from the beginning of that experience.
Okay, they were showing me a performance on
who's they?
Whoever that stocky woman was connected to, her people.
Okay, go ahead.
And so I had visited this there several times in very short periods, and I was seated in a chair, and they had dancers performing miraculously to the gravitational field. It took me a while, second or third time, before I couldn't understand why I had trouble standing up. I'd have to lean on a chair. We were sitting in what looked like regular seats to a movie theater. And there was a stage, and these people were performing on the stage. They're doing dance formations or some kind of dance. And so once I stood up, I could stand up, but getting to the standing up position, I couldn't figure out. So my third time there, I realized that it had to do with the gravitational field. And their performance seemed to be based on their ability to resist the gravitational field. The dances that they were doing on stage, that was kind of the way I put it together. I don't know who brought me there. I met her in what I thought another time I met her in a facility. It looked like a military facility. It was three floors, a long building, and we were in the second floor. And I met her there once, and then a couple times on her planet. The other group I was brought to, they looked much like us. It seemed like a primitive culture, tents. And the man that brought me there and showed me the people, he was kind of dressed like Jungle Jim. He had like a jungle outfit. So I don't know if he was military. I don't know if he was Palladian. So he introduced me to the villagers. And then their facial features frightened me, because they had our eyes, they didn't have our nose, they didn't have our mouth, but they had our body. And the one, they lived in what looked like marsh, wetland, tall grass. One of the women brought me to this tub. It was a giant tub, and it wasn't of their technology. So the only thing I surmised is the tub was used to control infection, disease. To her, it seemed magical. She wanted me to take my clothes off and get into the tub. And so I reluctantly took my clothes off, got into the tub. And the tub must have had some kind of filtration system, because it circulated water. oblong, all I knew is the tub didn't look like their technology. I visited there several times. They lived in what looked like wetlands.
So how did you get to this place?
Teleportated, I assumed.
Oh, so you all just, I don't just know. Appeared there and you were, you know.
Like, I had one conscious teleportation. And it was only one time did I actually have the actual teleportation consciously. And it's basically you're here and you're somewhere else instantaneously. And there doesn't seem to be any time lost. The time I was conscious was with the breeding program. A woman formed in my bathroom when I woke up. And then when I approached her, suddenly I was in her bedroom. Her bedroom looked of earth. The Pleidians use a gas for their breeding program. And it's in a little sprayer. When they spray it in your face, it's used to bring on sexual activity. And it usually brings it on pretty aggressively. And usually you have no memory of what occurs once they spray. I've talked to women that were part of the breeding program, and some of them describe it like being assaulted. I don't like it. It's horrible. But they often use it in their program.
So the grays are, most people, or not most people, a lot of people believe that the grays are breeding because they're a dying race. Now, you can't assume the same thing about, let's just for a moment assume that that's true. I'm not saying it is or it isn't.
Yeah.
But we can't make that assumption about the Pleiadians.
They told me this.
Who told you what?
The Greys. So when I'm giving you information, it's because of dialogue. The Greys, it was... their genetic structure... It was explained to me a couple of ways, but because that they gave me that as an explanation when I was angry with what they did to the girls, the screaming, the yelling, the horrific, and the Greys explained to me that they were losing the ability to reproduce with their own genetics, and they had to infuse human genetics to partially restore their genetics. That's kind of the way it was explained.
So what about the Pleiadians? Why are they breeding? What's the reason? If they're, are they also a dying race and they need more genetics?
No. A lot of the other celestial groups are involved in breeding. So it isn't just the Pleiadians, it isn't just the Greys. Not all of the ones that are reproduced stay on Earth. I haven't asked the Pleiadians about the breeding program.
So you don't know why?
I don't know why with the Pleiadians. I will ask. But I don't know why with the Pleiadians. I know they breed for other planets. I know that I don't know their specific reason for breeding. I don't know whether all the Celestials want to continue their genetic structures. I don't know. But there's a lot of breeding in the other Celestial groups as well.
So it's not just the Greys and the Pleiadians. How many different races do you think are?
Initially, I thought there was 12.
Breeding? Somebody
came up with that number.
You're saying 12 breeding or 12 here?
12 different celestial groups.
Okay, well, how many of those are breeding?
I found out 12 was not a correct number. There's a lot more than 12. Some of them are not carbon-based life forms. They're gaseous life forms.
So go ahead, tell us about the other celestials that you're familiar with and how you're familiar with them.
I was introduced to like 6 or 7 groups, but the communications I'm having with other contactees through Facebook and LinkedIn there was a lot more than 12. I initially thought there was 12 because one of the researchers came up with that number. But
so why do you think the other races are here if they're not breeding?
No, I think they are breeding.
Oh, you think all of the 6 or 7?
I think a lot of them are.
Okay.
A lot of them are soulmates. A lot of the contactees, abductees, are soulmates. Have had past lives in the civilizations of the celestials that abduct them or take them. So when the celestials show them their world, they're showing them the contactee's former world. As was the professor I was working with was saying something. He was saying, many celestials of the higher frequencies are coming to Earth to raise the frequency of Earth, whether to raise it into fifth dimension, but to raise the frequency of Earth.
And did they tell you, have you?
And I've seen evidence that kind of suggests that when I interview the other contactees. I haven't come across too many with Pleidian. I find the Pleidian channelings that I hear pretty much right on with the Pleidian aspects.
So how are the aliens raising our consciousness or vibration or whatever they're doing? How are they doing it?
Through the contacts. Through their contactees, their abductees, who come from the higher frequencies.
So when they're making contact, they're doing whatever to people to raise their consciousness while they're being in contact. Is that correct?
The contactee they're involved with is from their frequency.
Oh, you mean they have previous lives over there?
And the contactees are saying that, are describing instances where they're being shown the celestial worlds as their worlds that they came from.
Right, right. They chose to come to Earth, but before they were incarnated.
They didn't. No, I get the opposite from many. They don't know why to blank, blank. They're on this planet. They didn't want to be here. So I don't get the impression it was an agreement. But then the pre-birth agreements. But there's a lot of contactees that hate this planet. They don't understand this planet. The rules, the system, it makes no sense to them. They have trouble functioning in this planetary system. There are many of them that are aware of coming from a system without wars, without the killing of one another, very peaceful civilizations.
Well, I think there's a lot of humans who haven't come from those planets who don't understand the wars either.
I know. But the wars, as they've been explained to me, is greed. The system of profit is what they feel to be. The monetary system works to enslave.
Yeah, the wars are a way of gaining wealth. They are greed.
It's profit. It's and so in the Pleiadian culture, there's no such thing as a profit. There's no such thing as a corporation. The factor of greed isn't there.
So if we wiped out the communists and the corporate,
it's the whole planet. We're not an advanced system here.
Primitive.
We're very primitive, and that's why they took control of the nuclear and the atomic. They weren't going to trust it in man's hands.
So have any of your contacts ever mentioned anything about the future of this planet? Anything?
The only thing I've gotten, and that what the Pleiadians were preparing for us, was an evacuation. The figure I got, which I can't trust anything, was that Earth was going to be evacuated. It's going to be a period where the planet had to progress, that it couldn't sustain life. And the number given me was 31 years. That they have found planets, that Earth was going to be put into two different planets. And I think that has to do with those that serve one another and those that serve themselves. Those that serve themselves certainly make up the greed factor.
So have you heard anything from the aliens about disclosure at all?
I certainly don't think it's coming from man.
Well, we know that, but I mean, everybody knows that already.
Yeah. Well,
except for the people that are deluding themselves, thinking that we're dribbling out information, which isn't true. That's totally false.
The information the Celestials are giving their contactees is the disclosure I'm seeing. The technologies they're showing us. Ships with gravitational fields that are like walking on any planet. And we know man has these technologies and is certainly going to maintain them for the elite. The question, every military branch has involvement with a celestial group. The U.S. military has involvement with celestial groups. I don't think, this whole game that are UFOs real? When is man going to make first contact?
It's all just a game. So they're all pretending that they don't know. I got it. We all know that.
They're sharing it with their contactees. Their contactees are seeing the advanced technologies. So then it becomes the contactees sharing, as I've said in my writing, we're disclosure. It's not coming from, there's too much profit
in
ET technologies. They're not going to be shared.
So, that's why Kennedy was killed. He wanted to share with the Russians. So
there's a lot of reasons Kennedy was killed.
Well, I know, but he signed an order for the CIA and the military to share the ET technologies with the Russians.
Oh, that's,
10 days before he was killed.
Yeah. He also was dissolving CIA offices was starting the dissolving of the CIA offices.
Well, you could tell it's kind of all a conspiracy because the guy they put in charge of investigating his assassination was the CIA guy, John Dulles, who he fired from the CIA just before he died. So, you know, you put the guy, put the CIA guy in charge of investigating CIA assassination, you know, it's kind of obvious that...
And the FBI played a role with the hiding of his head. Naval intelligence, the reason the head disappeared was one of the bullets came from the driver. There were so much different pieces.
Well, if you've seen the video of the assassination, you know his brain flew out the back of his head, landed on the trunk. His wife went to grab it and almost fell out of the vehicle when she went to grab his brains that flew out the back of his head. So obviously the bullet came in the front.
There was a lot more than one bullet.
I know, but my point is if you shoot a soft object with a bullet, the trajectory of the bullet will carry the mass out as it goes through the head. It goes in small hole, comes out big hole.
Yeah, but we got five guns coming into his head.
Yeah, well.
The guys in the bush that all the witnesses died that testified to.
Yeah.
There was so many bullets flying, but his head disappeared when they were doing the evaluation.
Well, if you slow down.
And did you see how the car stopped?
If you slow down. How
when the bullets are flying, the car stops.
If you watch this Zapruder film frame by frame at a very slow speed, you can see a bullet coming from the front above him, from above him down at his body. You can see the bullet in the air in the film. It's hard to see if it's in full speed, but if you slow it down, it's real easy to see.
Yeah.
But in any case,
driver stopping the car at the times of the shooting made no sense to me. You don't stop when bullets are coming into the president. You take off.
Right, right. Well, there's a lot of weird things.
Yeah, but he pissed a lot of people off, John F. Kennedy.
Well, yeah.
The deals his father made with the Italians that he was supposed to carry through in his legislature. There's so much.
We're getting off the topic, though. So anyway, is there any other information you would like to impart about anything alien-related that you haven't mentioned so far?
Basically, that every military branch, as I said, has involvement with a celestial group. Not all the military groups are working cohesively. There's many different aims of the different military groups, some of which is based on the Celestials. There's a heavy Celestial involvement in our general culture, from the Reptilians, Masons, Republicans, all the way down. And that's kind of the message I've been giving. It's this idea that, oh, man has not communicated with Celestials. Are UFOs real? It's like, can't we get beyond this and start looking at the substance of what the Celestials are saying?
Well, they're not going to Congress. I don't know. You wonder if Congress is pretending along with the military, or Congress actually believes, you know, I don't know the Congress.
The Pentagon is having an investigation as to whether Celestials are real, which is ironic because there's been meetings with Celestials beneath the Pentagon.
Yeah.
There's a whole bunch of information that has been kept from our society on Celestial involvement with our society.
Of course, it's true. So I think unless you have some knowledge, specific knowledge, your own experiences that you haven't divulged yet that you would like to talk about, that we're kind of done. What do you think? You got something else you want to say about some experience you've had, or are you done?
It's kind of difficult to take thousands of abductions. I'm 70.
Is that many you've had? How many you've had? Thousands?
Many more than thousands. How many days to a year? There's a week I can have 4 and 5 in 1 week, where I can go without sleep in 1 week. I would put them in the tens of thousands, and that's a low number of my abductions since childhood.
And it's still mostly Pleiadians and Greys.
Pleiadians, Greys, and military.
Military.
Yeah. Those three groups. And then I hear that they're not in conjunction with one another, that they're working separately. And then I hear from another source they're in conjunction with one another. So there's many questions I don't have. And
so are you getting plenty of help from your hypnotists that you're working with?
We just started. I've been working with the hypnotist, but I stopped listening to the recordings because I gave up. When I first went to the hypnotist, I was looking to bring it together, and that wasn't happening. When I went into hypnotic state, I didn't remember when I came out of the hypnotic state what I said. And so I stopped listening.
Stop. That's a problem, because you see, when I learned hypnosis, we'd all sit in a circle, and he would take us all into trance together. And, and after it was all over, you know, after that particular session was all over, one of the first things he would ask everybody, is there anybody who did not remember everything? And invariably, every single time, there'll be one person who didn't remember everything. There were 9 out of 10 people in this group that were going in trance every single time. 9 out of 10 remembered everything.
Yeah.
So if you're not remembering everything, there is a problem right there.
Well, that's why I tried to get the assistance with the military on the blackouts. And now I finally get a therapist who understands the process, who's familiar with the abduction phenomena, and who's working with me to bring things together. But I gave up. And so there's hundreds of sessions, 2-hour sessions. I don't have a clue of what I'm saying.
So is that because why do you think you're not remembering?
Because with dissociative identity disorder, it's another personality.
Oh, so you're not remembering because the person being abducted was one of the other personalities.
Yeah.
Okay. So you need to reintegrate all of your personalities and recover memories on board both.
Well, yep. I'm assuming one will happen as a result of the other. As we bring the first, we're setting the personalities just to have their discussion with the therapist, not with the hypnotist. They've been having their discussion with the hypnotist for several years. So we're going to have work to bring the personalities into the office with the therapist. And then we're going to work with them coming together versus me forcing into them, which is what I was doing before. And was the pattern I was first doing with hypnosis. I was forcing the takeover of the personality in the ship. And what would happen is I wouldn't know where I was, and I wouldn't know what's going on, and I wouldn't know who the woman is I'm with. So the forceful way of integration doesn't work. We have to find an agreement, a base to work from, to bring us all together.
Well, if you get to a point in your life where you want to work with another hypnotist, give me a call. I mean, I'll be happy to work with you as much as you need. I won't charge you anything, and I'll do probably at least as good, if not considerably better job than anybody you've worked with so far. I put my clients' interests before my own, and whatever you need, I'll see that you get it.
I'd be definitely interested, but it's funny, I can't. Well, the first two hypnotists were given information away to a third party. So I discontinued with that.
So what? Who was this third party? That's...
One was MUFON, Massachusetts MUFON, which is the reason I didn't work with Massachusetts MUFON.
I got it.
New Hampshire MUFON. Massachusetts MUFON happened to have former FBI members in positions of leadership. And... NUFOR, a research group, was working to stop research, and they were finding a very effective way. So I couldn't work with Massachusetts. It was, and a lot of MUFON is integrated with the government.
Yeah, well, okay, so MUFON is...
So the woman I'm working with did release information.
Go ahead.
But... the military group I'm with also has contacts on land. They are part of the surveillance. They have, we dealt with both vehicle air surveillance. They have been very interested in the tapes, and they've basically were getting access to them through that. The hypnotist that I've made the most progress with. So to me, now that I know who the surveillance is, I'm no longer concerned with them. So I've gone back to working with that hypnotist. The Pleidians call us multidimensional cells. The Pleidians, when I've spoken to them about the personalities involved with them and the relationships with them, they seem to consider that part of it.
To consider what part of what?
The different personalities. Part of their celestial experience. When I'm telling them, when I discover the relationships with hypnosis, and asking them, and then it becomes the relationships are triggering the personality separations. So there's a lot in this puzzle we're working on to resolve, but it almost seems like the relationships trigger a particular personality.
Well, okay.
The relationship with a particular Pleidian gets one particular personality.
Well, here's my suggestion. Okay, if you feel like you want to work with somebody else, not for whatever reason, just give me a call. And here's what we can do. I just thought about this just now as we're talking. Skype, I record it, so I have the recording, right?
Yeah.
But we don't have to use Skype. We can use Zoom. Zoom records locally. So you'll have a copy, I'll have a copy, and there won't be first of all, I'm not going to give anybody my copy, except unless I put it out on YouTube. And everybody's got it. but it's not going to be given to anybody privately. So, but your copy, I mean, and I don't have to even put it out on YouTube. That's up to you. But,
yeah.
But in any case, if we do it on Zoom, you'll have a copy. I'll have a copy. If you want, I'll put mine on YouTube. If you don't want, I'll just keep it private. But it, that's up to you. But you'll have a copy of it with you at all times, so that, you know, you could watch it in the same day, next day, as many times as you like, and you don't have to go get a copy or ask me for a copy or anything like that. You'll have it automatically, and your wife can listen to it the next day or whatever.
My wife's another story on this. My wife has discovered abductions because they've done some markings on her, but I can't speak much about her. Everybody in this house has basically been abducted, including my new wife. The Grays have done corrective procedures on her for a particular ailment she had, but she doesn't want discussion like many people don't outside of. But one question that I would be very interested in finding an answer to has to do with how one particular Pleidian triggers a particular personality, so that only one personality is interacting with her, and it's the same one. That's the big question that's coming up.
Well, my guess, if I had to guess why that was happening, with the Grays, with aliens, period, they're going to want to, they're like humans, they're going to want to do whatever they do to get what they want, regardless of who they are. Regardless of whether they're good guys, bad guys, whatever, they've got their own, everybody's got their own agenda, even if they're good guys or bad guys, regardless, right? Yeah. So, if the Grays want to keep their breeding process secret, in your case, all they got to do is trigger the other personality, and then there's no question about whether it's going to stay secret or not. And it's the same with any of the races. If they want to keep their stuff secret, they just trigger a different personality.
Okay. Well, for example, Sumo is a female that I was involved with, but I have no memory of Sumo, no conscious memory of her. But she came alive when I got married.
You mean one of your personalities?
Sumo is a woman that the personality was interacting with.
Oh, okay.
When she found out I got married, she had a fit and even made an appearance.
Because she's considered you hers.
Yeah. Now, I have no memory of anything of that relationship. But so what we did is we talked to the boyfriend personality of Sumo. And he gave us some information, him being another personality, but he was very guarded as to sharing information. So my question is, how come Sumo gets a particular personality she interacts with every single time that I have no consciousness of?
Well, she likes that particular part of you, I guess.
Yeah. But so it's the women seem to bring about a personality. They trigger particular personalities, the Pleiadians. And my question is why? You know, why is it the same personality that relates to this particular person? And so that's something we're looking at. Because if I see a particular personality in an abduction, it's going to bring the personality that has been relating to her, not me. If I come in, which I was doing, I was pushing myself in, then I'm with a woman I don't know, in a place I don't know.
So have you gone over all the aliens you've encountered so far? Have you gone over all of them?
I'm reviewing the tapes I never listened to.
No, I mean, right. When I said go over all the details of all the alien races you've had direct contact with, have you gone over, are there any others that you have missed, that you've not gone over? Any other aliens that you've encountered?
If I don't have memory, then I wouldn't know.
Oh, okay.
So there could be.
Yeah, I know there could be some that you're not familiar with.
It's an interaction with a particular female.
Yeah, so, but you've kind of gone over your whole story pretty much.
Yeah.
Laid it all out. All right, well, this is probably a good time to end this then.
But yeah, I am interested in looking at the question of you speaking.
Of triggering personalities.
So yeah, of looking at the personality relating to one celestial.
So when you, I got maybe one more question. So when the hypnotist takes you into trance, do you tend to stay in your current personality or do you tend to switch?
It totally switches.
So have you told the hypnotist to give you suggestions to stay in your current personality so that you'll have a recollection of what's...
No, we haven't done that specifically, but she'll go back to me in between the other personalities.
Say again?
Let's say, she'll say, Jim, tell us this, tell us what's this. Kenneth, tell us this. All right, now we're going to go back to you, to Ken. I'm Ken. And then she'll talk to me as Ken. And then she'll tell me what Kenneth said or what Jim said.
Right.
But when she goes to the personalities, I have no awareness.
As an MKUltra victim, you think that most of the time they use your other personalities for assassinations? Is that the primary use?
They use Brian for that.
Okay. What about Kenneth and the others?
No. Well, Kenneth is involved with the military, but Kenneth won't speak of that. So with Kenneth at night, I'm involved with the military with Kenneth. But Kenneth, we think is a... I'm starting to look at no answers and starting with no answers instead of assumptions.
Because Kenneth is another spirit, right?
That's what we're assuming, but Kenneth is active in the nights.
You mean currently?
Yeah, but Kenneth will not talk to you or speak to you of those projects.
When your hypnotist takes you into trance, does Kenneth come out?
Yeah, comes out very easily. Actually, I can speak him. Ask him a question, he'll give me... He's been with me since childhood.
Okay, so let's get into Kenneth for a moment. I mean, I thought we'd run out of interesting things to talk about, but it sounds like maybe we haven't. So, Kenneth is another spirit from another place. And how much about Kenneth do you understand? Since he's put you in his place, in his world, how much of that world do you understand?
Kenneth is involved with the military.
No, I'm not talking about... Okay. I'm not talking about what he's doing here. I'm talking about his world. If he's a spirit, he's a non-corporeal spirit of human, of previous human origin, or he could be a human that's going out of his body and getting into yours.
He uses this body.
Right. The point is that most likely he's non-corporeal altogether, and maybe he's former human. And he's really a dead, or not dead, but a previous, he had a body.
Yeah.
Now he doesn't have a body, and now he uses your body, but there's not, how do I put this? There's not a great motivation for non-corporeal spirits to work with the grays. You know, I don't
understand. The grays that him broke up.
Well, hold on, back up, stop for a second. I don't really understand how somebody who used to be a human, who's no longer in a body, can have a motivation, A, to be here on Earth, other than just wandering around, B, to use your body to help an alien race. You get my drift, where I'm coming from?
He's using my body to help a military.
Okay, so what motivation does a former human who used to have a body have for helping the military? There's a disconnect.
Kenneth says he was with me. He says we're two souls in the same body.
So he's just using your body to stay alive in this world.
He's doing something with the military, and the military did not want us having the discussions between the medium and him.
Yeah, I got that, but I understand all that. Okay. All right. He's helping the military. The military doesn't want you to know. Fine.
Yeah.
Not a problem. What I'm trying to figure out is what motivates somebody who's passed on from this world to stay here. And, you know, okay, there are people who pass on. They fear to go to the light. And so they stay in the astral realm or they stay on Earth. Fine. Well, let's say they stay on Earth. Then he's got your body to play with. So
yeah.
This is something I can understand why he might do that. The part that I don't quite understand is why is he motivated to help the military if he has no real place here on Earth? He's just using your body temporarily here and there. I don't see any reason for him helping the military at all for any reason. That's the part I can't quite figure out. Why does he help the military if he's just coming and going from your body? Okay. Does he stay in your body permanently? Is he there?
He stays in my body when he's working with the military.
Oh, but where, when you're in control of your body, where is he?
He's not here.
He's gone.
Yeah.
He's doing whatever.
Yeah. At night.
Yeah, he goes with the military. Helps the military. Yeah, I got that. So I'm trying to get some hidden stuff, something that you haven't spoken of yet.
Yeah, I think you need to talk to Kenneth.
Right. Maybe you don't know this information, and I'm just trying to point out to you that Kenneth should not have a motivation to help the military for any reason, because he doesn't have a permanent body that is his body. I mean, he obviously thinks your body is his body, but generally, okay, how do I put this? Some people don't want to go into the light. They don't want to hang out in the astral plane. They want to stay on Earth, so they get somebody's body. They grabbed a body. Oh, they've got your body. Okay, so now they've got your body. So he's got your body, right? So where does his motivation come to help the military?
I don't know anything that you're saying.
Yeah, I understand. I'm just pointing
out.
That's
why I would
say,
if you were to speak to Kenneth.
Right. I got you.
Then you can get those answers to the questions you're asking.
Yeah, well, maybe if we do work together as a hypnotherapist client thing, I'll talk to Kenneth. Until that happens, this is all speculation.
Yeah.
All right. Well, is there anything you want to say before we end this discussion?
Not that I can think of, but I definitely would like to work with you with hypnosis.
All right. Well,
have a different angle.
Well, one of the things you need to do to have a successful hypnosis session, you need to get everything you want out of the session. And in order to get everything you want out of the session, you have to know what you want going into the session. So I would suggest you write down Let's just say you can't ran into a genie and you could have every wish that you could ever think of about everything you could ever think of in relation to recovering memories, reintegrating your personalities, just everything. Write it all down in order.
That's what I do with the sessions. Right. I tell the hypnotist what questions to ask, what personalities to speak to.
Right, right. So it seems like you're already getting what you need from your current hypnotist.
Unfortunately, I didn't remember. But yeah.
But if you feel like you want to work with me, it seems like maybe you're not getting everything you're looking for.
No, I stopped listening to the tapes for 2 years because what I was hoping for didn't come.
Well, you...
So now I'm listening to the sessions I didn't listen to for two years.
If you want to do, work with me, I'm great with that. But in order for us to have the maximum benefit to you, you need to list every single thing you want. It's not necessarily that you have to come up with the questions, but you have to come up with the what you wish to succeed in, as in what, reintegrate this with that, or find out this information or whatever. As long as you got a list of everything you want to achieve in each session, we'll go for that and see how much we can achieve in the shortest amount of time. I don't like wasting my time or your time.
Yeah.
If we're going to do something, we need to make sure that you get what you are after in every single session. So make your list and call me when you're ready.
All right. And are you on Messenger?
No, I don't even know what that is.
Messenger? Okay, that's with Facebook. Okay.
Oh, okay. No, I'm not. I don't really get into Facebook. That.
Okay. Do you have?
I have access to Facebook, but I just don't use it that
much. Yeah. No, I'm looking for a medium. I'm a writer, so mentally I process.
Right.
So I'm looking for a medium of writing to you on what we're discussing.
LinkedIn or email?
Oh, email would be best. Hang on.
I'm sure you have my...
I think you gave it to me.
The email, yeah. I just sent you...
You just sent me.
Yeah, it's got my email address on there. Just email me what you want to do, when you want to do it. You can always... You can't reach out to me on Skype very much because I keep my Skype turned off most of the time.
Okay, I don't use it, but I think we'll get an idea with some dialogue back and forth of what we want to look at.
Sure. Contact me whenever you want to, and we'll get into it. Yeah. So is there anything else you want to say before we end the session?
I can't think of anything. I appreciate the opportunity of speaking with you, and I feel that you might be able to help me with questions that I can't get answers to.
Well, but when it comes to aliens and Mkultra and anything else that I can get into, that I don't charge for anything like that, so don't worry about the money. Just let me know what you want and we'll take care of it. Yeah. And I've gone through mind control stuff myself, so
yeah,
I know what you're going through. I only went through about a week of it, but I have had other connections with it a little bit here and there. Anyway, it's good to have you on. Thank you for being on my show, and we will talk to you again soon. And I'm going to go ahead and stop the recording. Here we go.